Join us for the Business Leadership Series, where we sit down with leaders who are making an impact on their worlds. I'm your host, Eric Champagne.
The most important thing for anybody who wants to start out on their own is do the work.
A leader can't always be shoveling muck and mud.
Never underestimate the people in your community around you.
We're not learning these lessons, and these lessons are becoming painful because of the poor operational security.
You don't really know anything as an entrepreneur until you actually get your product out there, so it can just be ripped apart.
Join us Sundays on this station at 9 a.m.
The days of just marketing your business and product are over. If you want to succeed, you have to think differently to stand out.
It's not even a baseball game, it's a circus. It's a circus.
Taking pages from a magazine.
If you're like everyone else, you're going to get results like everyone else.
Cause we're gonna be legend. Gonna get their attention.
I believe every business has one thing that makes them stand out. It's the best version of themselves. If you want more, you gotta do more. It's as simple as that.
Got this feeling in our souls, we can't.
Whatever's normal, do the exact opposite. And for me, normal gets normal results.
Cause we're gonna be legends.
The next step is to love your customers more than you love your product.
What is the perfect experience for your customer? Start there.
Attention beats marketing 1,000% of the time.
You know, it's the difference you make in people's life that matters most. Everything we do is fans first, and that's to take care of our customers. Be patient in what you want for yourself, but be impatient in how much you give to others.
So stand out, be different, have fun, and enjoy the show. Thank you.
Hey, I want to thank Jesse Cole for joining us today. Doesn't need an introduction. Some of us know him, but he's with the Savannah Bananas. And Jesse, I thought it'd be cool if you take a few minutes. I know you've told it 100 times, but give us some insight about you pre-COVID, and then we'll talk about COVID and future.
Sure. Yeah. We run a probably the lowest level of baseball team there is, a college summer baseball team, which we basically decided 15 years ago we weren't going to be in the baseball business. We're going to be in the entertainment business. And why do we make that decision? Because I became the general manager of the worst performing team in the entire country in Gastonia, North Carolina. And so that's how you get a job as a GM. It's a terribly performing team that no one wants. So I took that job at 23 years old. And 200 fans coming to the games, $268 in the bank account my first day, and the team was an absolute failure. And so I learned very quickly that we weren't going to be the best baseball team, but we had to focus on something that we could be the best at. And I was asked, what business are you in? What business are you really in? And for us, we had to be in the entertainment business because we were never going to be great at baseball. So we quickly pivoted and started talking about dancing players, grandma beauty pageants, flatulence fun nights, salute to underwear nights. We tried it all. All you're probably like, what does that have to do with me? Well, nothing at all. But that's literally what the business that we decided to be in because it was what our fans actually wanted. And so we realized the biggest frustration for all people in baseball games, especially lower levels, was it was too boring. And we heard it over and over and over again. And so the starting point for all innovation for us became is what are those friction points? So we changed the model from being about long, slow, and boring to making about nonstop fun and entertaining. And that's where kind of it started with our Gastonia team. We went to 1,000 fans, 2,000 fans, started selling out games, decided I had zero debt in my life, so might as well take on millions of dollars of debt. So I started buying teams, and that happened with Gastonia about 6-7 years ago, bought that team, sold it, went down to Savannah, Georgia. So, and that's where kind of a lot of things really blew up for us. Long story short, Savannah, Georgia showed up. There was professional baseball there for 90 years, but they failed. Only a couple hundred fans coming to the games. We thought we could make it successful. We were wrong in the beginning, at least. We showed up. It was myself, my wife, our 24-year-old president, and three 22-year-olds to run the team. And the former team had cut the phone lines, cut the internet lines. They took everything out of the ballpark. It was a disaster. And so we started calling everyone in the city asking, hey, you want to buy tickets? And everyone's like, who are you guys? No. And so we sold just 2 tickets in our first 3 months. So I know this is about sales and marketing. If this was 5 years ago, you'd be like, what the heck is this guy doing on the call? He's the worst sales and marketer there is. And the truth is, I was, and we were, because we were trying to be like everyone else. I wasn't wearing the yellow tuxedo. I was doing the same social media ads. I was doing the same newspaper, radio, everything like everyone else. And I got results like everyone else. In fact, much worse. And the reality is we didn't have the attention of the market. No one knew who we were. And so we knew we had to get dramatically different, especially with the fact that just 4 years ago, on January 15th, 2016, at 4:45 on a Friday, I got the phone call that we had overdrafted our account and we were completely out of money. And so that's when my wife and I, we sold our house, we emptied out our savings account, and we put the little money that we had into the team and we're sleeping on an airbed. And Emily, being great, the airbed we had was a twin airbed. And so if you've been on a twin airbed, it's about this small. And so literally in the middle of the night, I would get up and get water and get a drink, and I would come back down to the airbed and Emily would be airborne. So it was a ridiculous living experience that we had back just, you know, 4 or 5 years ago. And it was such so bad, we knew we had to create attention. So the first thing we did is we said, all right, every team is naming themselves, you know, boring, the sailors, the anchors, the boring names. So we said, let's get dramatically different, not just name the team after a fruit, the Savannah Bananas. We kept going with it. We said we could have a senior citizen dance team called the Banana Nanas. We could have a mascot named Split. We could have a male cheerleading team called the Man Nanas, but now they're just our dad bod cheerleading squad. Then we kept going. We could have literally banana in the pants promotions. We could sell Dolce and banana underwear, which we do. We have the big banana and the small banana on the crotch, and the big banana outsells the small banana dramatically. It's not even close. We put our players in music videos and did Can't Stop the Peeling, where we actually had our players singing during the games. And we just came with all these ideas and people started paying attention. And all of a sudden we didn't have to market like we were before. And we started again with the friction points. How do you create attention by doing something different? But also, baseball games, you get nickel and dimed. So we made every single ticket all inclusive. Every ticket include all your burgers, your hot dogs, your chicken sandwich, your soda, your water, your popcorn, your dessert, everything for $15 total. People were like, what is this? And so once they started cutting, they came to the first few games, all they did was tell everyone this is different than any baseball game I've been to. And fortunately, after just selling two tickets, we've now sold out every single game and have a wait list for tickets in the thousands. And it's been a wild ride. We spend $0 on marketing right now, but we spend everything on experience. So from a 20-piece pep band to a professional high fiver, which won't work this year, but was great last year. It was a 6-year-old kid, and his job was to high five everyone in the stadium. And he high fived about 2,000 fans a game, and he was perfect. And so from a 10-year-old co-host that wore a green tuxedo because he's not quite ripe, we try to think of every opportunity to focus on the experience, break dancing, first base coach, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And that might not you know, fit for all you guys because it's very entertainment focused, but it's still focused on what we could be the best at and how do we eliminate those frustrations. We have no ticket fees, no convenience fees, which are the most inconvenient fees in the world. We have an ad-free stadium. We've eliminated every single ad from our ballpark, no sponsorship, because we don't believe anyone shows up to a ballpark and wants to be advertised to, wants to be sold, wants to be marketed to. People want to buy, they want to be a part of something. And so we've gone so all in on this with everything we've done that we are so fortunate now that we have evangelists that are just spreading our word. To give you an example, we have our Slippery Banana drink. It's a liquor drink that is probably one of the strongest drinks out there. And but fans love it. It's all alcohol, but it tastes like a banana pina colada. And we've had it at our games and we said, all right, what can we do right now during this virus to give something to our fans? And it's shelter in place. Everyone's at home. But we said, let's do a drive-through. And so we set up a drive-through these past 2 weeks just for one day each. And the cars started 2 hours in advance before just to get a liquor drink. And drive-through liquor, like we're moonshining at our ballpark. I don't even know if it's legal. It probably isn't. But the reality is we've created fans that they show up yesterday. They just said, we just wanted to see you guys. What are you selling? And I'm like, well, you got two kids in the back. It's probably not good for them. But I was like, oh, I'll get a couple. And some people didn't even know exactly what we were selling. And I think it's because we've taken the philosophy of serve over sell. And the name of our company is Fans First Entertainment. And right now during this virus, every one of our team is content producers and entertainers, from music videos that we're putting out to involving our fans in contests to doing Facebook Lives like crazy That's what we're doing, even though that's not direct revenue. But when we do put something on sale, they show up. And the last 2 days, the Slippery Banana that we've done, it has sold out in 23 and 27 minutes. And we doubled the production both times. So fortunate. I know it shows a lot of the positives. We've had some huge failures. That's a whole nother conversation. Some promotions don't work, like the Living Pinata, where we actually put an intern in a turtle costume and had kids with plastic bats hit them on the field while they threw candy up in the air. That's a promotion we won't do again. So there's a lot of things we try that don't work, but it's all in the name of fun for us. And we've been fortunate with success. So
Jesse, take a few minutes on that. First of all, thank you so much again. I know you get paid a lot of money before things were paused to go and speak on stages all over the country. And so I appreciate you taking your time with our small group. Really appreciate it. You and I have talked quite a bit. In fact, we talked a few weeks ago and we're having just a great chat. And I said, man, you got some great energy around what's happening right now. I got it. Can I interview you again? How about you try jumping on this mastermind and let us do some Q&A and talk? But hey, I want to hear, tell us a little bit more about how you do tests, because you've tested so many things. And a lot of us go, hey, I don't know if that fits with my brand or like, how do you do tests? That's one question I have. Yep. And then also, how do you get your team to buy in at the level that you do? Because you guys are doing some crazy stuff.
Sure. Everything for us is based on ideas. So our whole company is based on ideas and we talk about them freely. But the practical thing that you can do with your team is that when we're together, we have an idea box. And every month, and now we're doing it bi-weekly as we're apart, we have an idea palooza. And I can't tell you about how much fun and purpose and meaning this gives to our group. So we start the idea palooza with a question that we're trying to solve for our fans. So for instance, the one we just had 2 weeks ago, what can we do to entertain our fans at home right now? And every single person on our team contributes 3 ideas. And it goes into this idea box. And we have a meeting, obviously used to be in person, where we get together, there's drinks involved, it's fun. Not Slippery Bananas, that would get too crazy. But we come up with these ideas and we say either yes, maybe, or needs work. And then at the end of the idea palooza, we all decide who's owning each one. And then within a week or two, we say, what are those steps that they've done this? And some of our best ideas have come from this. And so that is huge for us. And we've built this into basically when we have an idea, we test it, we experiment it. And I'll give a great example of that. We had an intern start with us just 3 months ago. And the first day we doll it up, make it a big celebration, but he spends an hour with me and Emily, my wife. And we always ask, what ideas do you have? And he said, you know, Jesse, I love that you guys, you know, call every fan that buys a ticket and give them a thank you call. I think that's really cool, but it should be more fun. And I go, well, what do you mean? He goes, well, I was thinking, what if it was a rap? I go, a rap? He goes, yeah, like a thank you rap. Like we do a rap to them on the phone. I go, I love it. He goes, cool. I go, you're going to do it by the end of the day. And he goes, what do you mean? I go, you're going to do the rap by the end of the day. And he goes, well, no, I'm kind of awkward. I'm like, perfect. Your name's Austin. You're Austin, the awkward bananas rapper. Like that's who you are right now. And so by the end of the day, he was writing this rap and I said, you're going to do it to a fan live. And he's like, I'm nervous. I'm scared. I go, what's the worst that can happen? And so at 4 o'clock, he got on the phone. We were calling someone because we weren't selling tickets at that point. We called someone for merchandise and he goes, hi, this is Austin, the bananas awkward rapper. I'm here to fill your day with fun, joy, and laughter. I hope you enjoy your perch and love this delicious merch or whatever, fantastic merch. And he did this ridiculous rap. And the person at the end was like, huh, man, that was good. Thanks, man. And Austin's like, it worked. I go, what did you expect would happen? And so now every day, I don't know what else he does. He writes raps and does raps to fans. But the model was the idea to say, hey, here's an idea. Let's implement it by the end of the day. And I think we always have these ideas and we're just like, oh, that's pretty good. Just test it, like test. And if it's 1.0, 2.0, his raps are much better now than they were before. They're still ridiculously awkward. He's an awkward dude, but it makes it fun for the fans. So I think that's part of our whole idea culture is what are we testing and what are we doing? One more example, Derek, on that.
Please.
Last Friday, 2 Fridays ago, we said, all right, hey, we want a music video right now. And so our director of entertainment said, let's do Dancing with Myself. It's fitting. So we said, all right, what do we have to do? So we called all of our staff, our coaches, our players. And we said, we need this by Sunday at noon. Sunday at noon, get the videos into a Google Drive, and we're going to release it by Wednesday and edit and done. And so you put a time frame. So constraints help us get the ideas. What's the deadline to get it done? And let's just do it.
So. It's a great video, too. I enjoyed that.
Thank you.
Jesse, talk to me about how you get your fans first how do you always make sure with your core values and with the thread of your business that you always keep that your focus? That's one question. And part two is, I need you to tell me more about the taking sponsors out of the stadium, because I remember you and I talked a year ago and I advised you not to do that. So I'm glad you
I'm not a good listener at some point, so I apologize, Derek. For us, the name of our company is Fans First Entertainment. Our mission is Fans First, Entertain Always. Every decision we make is at Fans First. We go undercover fan at all of our games. I took off the tux. We go in and we park with the fans. We walk in with the fans. We drive with the fans. We have an empty seat at every meeting that represents the fans, because we make decisions based on them. We have shoes that our fans gave to us. They give me weird yellow shoes. I go, these are our fan shoes. All right, put yourself in them before you make a decision. We do all of this type of symbolism to make sure that we're always making decisions based on them. In our lobby during the off season, when fans walk in, our director, our Fans First director and our employee experience director, they stand immediately. When any fan walks into the building, we stand. And it sounds cheesy, but we stand for our fans. And similar to what the president walked in, you stand. It's just a respect. And so it's talked about over and over again before every meeting. Hey, what's our mission? Fans first, entertain always. All right, guys, what are our core beliefs? The fans first way, and we go through that. The repetition. So that's how it's built into our culture. We have a fans first playbook that we share with everyone. Our players don't get a uniform until they go through our fans first onboarding and fans first you. It's everyone. You don't get to actually be a part of this until you go through it. So that's reiterated, and they know, hey, the players are here not to play baseball. They're here to actually for the fans, as crazy as that sounds. So that's how we talk about it. Your second question was getting rid of ads and not listening to you. Yes. All right. Yes. Again, what do we stand for? And this is something that I think everyone thinks is crazy, because, it doesn't really take away from the experience. You know, there's billboard ads everywhere. But my question, does it add to the experience? And we're a 1926 ballpark and historic, and we really stand for the fans. Plastering ads all over the stadium, which we also don't believe in the sense that I'll say this, that I would not spend $25 on a static billboard at a stadium, even the fact that we're selling at every game. And we should never sell something you don't believe in. So it went against what we were doing. And also, we just believe that the future of advertising and marketing isn't really based on that. It's based on the experiences you provide, and your customers, your fans do all the marketing for you. If we're spending $0 on marketing, why are we selling marketing to other people? And so that's why we do workshops and we speak about, hey, create an experience that's so remarkable that you never have to market again in your life. And so it was very, the industry ripped us apart on that. But here's what exactly happened. And we didn't expect this. In the first week, we did 4 times the merchandise we do per day online. And we got over 15 messages said, I'm buying this shirt and this hat just because of who you guys are and what you stand for and that you went ad free. And so that made even a bigger statement that we're always going to have the backs of the fans. So it's a long game. It's a short-term profit hit for a long-term fan. And we're always focused on long-term fans over short-term profits.
What does the future look like, Jesse, as you expand this concept and what you're doing? What's the big picture?
For our next, where we're going?
Yes.
We're going to take the show on the road. So basically, we know that we've been fortunate with what we do at our games, that people say it's an absolute circus and they've never seen baseball like this, that we're going to take that to more places. And while that's extremely hard right now from a live experience, the first question we're asking, how can we show that from a digital? How can we have subscribers to that can't get games to start there and then build that fan base and then take it to different cities? And I'll share with you, Derek, we're not going to go big. Everything's a small bet. As crazy as that getting rid of the ad free sounds like, oh, that's big. It was 10% of our total revenue. Most teams, it's 50%. It was 10%. We were okay. We had enough margins that we'd be okay. Next spring, we're not going to do a huge world tour. We're going to do a one city world tour. So it'll be the one city world tour. And we're going to pick only one city that the bananas will come to and then build that up, sell that out. And then next year, go to 2 cities or 3 cities or 4 cities. And I know this is about sales and marketing, but I would say one of the biggest things that we've learned that we don't talk about at all is the power of demand. And everything, the reason our games sell out, it's all strategic on demand. You know, we started with the weekends the first year and the Thursdays, and now everything we unveil, it's never to max out how much profit we can make. It's to max out the experience, but also max out the demand. And so the slippery bananas, the first week we did it 2 weeks ago, only 100 available. Then we did 200 available. We'll go to 300 just because the demand, there were 50 cars that didn't get any on yesterday. So we could say as much as you want, and there's no demand, there's no excitement. So that's known in sales and marketing, but I don't know if it's practiced as much because, oh, I can make more money. No. Play the long game, build the demand. We did a 24-hour t-shirt. We just tried it. Only one chance to get a 24-hour t-shirt. And we did over 1,000 shirts. And it was mind-blowing what happened. And the most shirts we've ever done in a day is maybe 100. Because of that demand, you only have 24 hours to get this exclusive shirt. It'll never be available again. And so that's what we've been testing more, is this demand concept.
Jesse, just a couple more questions. You've got an exciting business. You're in entertainment. I've talked about this before, but what does a bank, what does a manufacturing company do? What does an event venue do? How do you make a tech company? How do you apply these principles to a company that's maybe not as sexy or as exciting or can be on the nose as something in entertainment?
Sure. And we've worked, so we actually, just before the virus, we were working with a bank in Kentucky. And the big thing, as many of you guys know, it's how do you map the experience? How do you make people want to feel? One question we ask everyone is to stop looking at your customers and clients as customers and clients. Change your language to fans. It's very easy in a sports world, but change it to fans, because there's a difference. Customers are transactional. They come and go, but fans never leave. When you think of a fan of someone, they're passionate, they're enthusiastic, they're loyal. So if you think of things as fans, what does that look like? So what we do is what we call the PFT, which is the perfect fan testimonial. If you could write one Google review, if you could have one review about your company, about your service, about what you provide, only one, what would you want it to say? And so what we did is we crafted this for ourselves, and we said, it's the most fun I've ever had at a baseball game. It was like a circus and a baseball game broke out. And we craft our entire experience by that, from literally when they buy the ticket. So if you're whatever your service is, what happens when people buy from you? What's that buying experience? Is it like everyone else? Is there an email confirmation like everyone else? So like, we make it fun. Our video, as soon as someone buys a ticket, it gets a video of me and says, congrats, you just made the best decision of your day. Right now, as you bought your ticket, a high priority siren went off at our stadium and our Bananiacs ran to the ticket laboratory to produce your tickets. And then a banana nana slowly walked in and hand selected your tickets and placed them on a silk pillow. We raised the silk pillow up in the air and we all sang Na Savanya to celebrate the birth of a new fan. And then we walked your tickets down to our vault where they're in maximum security, ready for you to go bananas. And people are like, what is happening right now? That's the first impact. So I would challenge that anybody, when they interact with you, whether it's on your website, whether they're buying from you, what happens that next step? You can start the experience there. And so that's where we map, and every company has that. So that buying experience, that one moment, is it remarkable? That's the question. I think Seth Godin said it more than anything, is what you're doing remarkable, or is it normal like everyone else? And we question everything from our voicemail. Our voicemail is, Savannah, na, 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 you've reached the Savannah bananas, na, 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 that ridiculous song by Camilo Caballo. We change it up regularly. And then our hold music is ring, 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 banana phone, that kid song. And every 2 weeks, people call and say, can you put us on hold? I'm like, you want to be put on hold? Like, what is wrong? They want to hear the hold music. So what would make people want to listen to your hold music? What would make people want to listen to your voicemail? What about your email signature? Those are the questions. Turn the normal into remarkable. And we've kind of looked at that in all facets of our team.
Jesse, what kind of commitment does that take? Because I love it. It seems like I love it. And some of us might be thinking, well, what mindset do I have to have all the time to keep doing that? I mean, you guys are just always thinking of how do you keep it fresh and keeping your fans engaged.
Thanks for the fresh. We actually, when we ever send our merchandise in our yellow box, we have a delivered fresh in our box. So that I like that. It's iterations, guys. 1.0. 15 years ago, the only thing we were doing different is we had dancing players who were terrible dancers. That was the only thing that we had, was them dancing. And then we go to 2.0, 3.0, 4.0. Our merchandise is probably the best example. We first started just shipping that like everyone else. And then we got a yellow box. And then we got yellow tissue paper. And then we got a delivered fresh stamp. And then we started putting a free koozie. Then we had a special note that said, this has been sprinkled with potassium. And we just started putting little language in there. And it's all gone to different iterations. So just start with that first one, and then you can start evolving. And so I think that's, which area do you want it? Which area is it that can have the biggest impact? Start making that a remarkable experience. And then you'll start looking at it in everything you do.
Yeah, I love that. Take just a couple of minutes, if you don't mind. You and I were talking the other day, and just both of us were excited, not excited about what's happening in the world, but that there is opportunity out there. And if you see it, tell me what your mindset is right now, just in general, the landscape, And then for you specifically with this COVID thing happening.
Yeah, so I mean, it's a create over consume. I think everyone right now is in consume mode. And so we're creating. And so it's asking those questions. So, you know, for us, how do we distribute differently? Whether that's our product, our experience, how do we not sell? How do we make sure that we're not out there just sell? We've always believed that. But, you know, I think the first step for us and for you guys who have teams, the first question, the thing we said is how do we focus more on and doing more for our team? So right now everyone's furloughs, letting people go, cutting salaries. Find a way to go the opposite way. And a lot of times it's not money. First thing my wife did, Emily, she wrote 30 plus thank you letters to all people on our team, their significant others, their family members. That was the first thing she did. The next week we went grocery shopping for our team, and she knew that I would get ridiculous items. So I got like Lunchables and snack packs and like Hot Pockets, and she got real food for them. But we delivered it to their house. We also bought their favorite drinks, which we haven't delivered yet. We'll be in the next week or so. We're just thinking of those little things that we can do for our team to show that we're caring for them. And then that shows how to care for our fans. A great example, the other day, one of our fans said, man, I wish I would love some Oreo cookies and milk right now. I wish Walmart delivered. And our vice president saw it, sent to our ticket experience coordinator. And within an hour, there was Oreo cookies and milk in her mailbox. And listen carefully, respond creatively. So that's big picture, but break it down little. What can you do for your team to show them that you're there? Over-communicate, have a rallying cry, get them all working on one thing together, show hope, paint a picture of what it's going to be like at the end. You know, we're painting that picture of opening night with the ambulances coming in and the field lined up with nurses and doctors and the whole stadium singing the national anthem together. We've painted that picture, so we're all working towards that right now. What's that picture that you're painting for when this is over so that you guys can all work towards that?
Yeah, awesome. Thank you. If you don't mind, if we can take a few minutes with Q&As. Amber started. Amber, I'll let you ask the questions if you want to come off of mute, and if you don't mind sharing who you are and what your business is as well. If we can get you off mute.
She's off mute, but I got to say, Amber, I love you. You've been laughing. Amber, I love you. You've been laughing the whole time. Like, I've been like focusing on this like hyena laugh from you. And so I'm not even looking
at you. I cried. So, Jesse, I wore my yellow suit today also, but I have taken it off lately. But
okay.
You're amazing. You're amazing. So, yeah, my questions are just more like your personal life right now. And it's a three-part question. And what are your daily rituals or routines to keep you going? And have you been able to maintain them during this pandemic? And if so, how? But you kind of answer the if so, how by just saying sure. So just like amped.
Sure. No, I appreciate it. In our Fans First playbook, great question. We have our three loves. So we talk about the whole time. Love your customers more than you love your product. Love your people more than you love your customers, and then love yourself above all, which sounds crazy. But that thing, which I never understand, I have a 2-year-old son, and if you're in a plane, give them oxygen first. I still don't, give yourself oxygen first. I still don't understand that, but I do when it comes to, especially now. You guys all know this, but I mean, if you can't take care of yourself, you can't take care of other people. So very intentional. My mornings, Hal Elrod, Miracle Morning, helped me tremendously. Win the morning, win the day. Every morning for me, I read, I run while listening to a podcast. I write a thank you letter. I've been doing the thank you experiment since 2016. I've written a thank you letter every single day. That's changed my life alone. I have a journal I write in every morning, and I do 10 ideas every morning. Most of them are terrible ideas. I can never even share most of them. But that's my morning. And I do that before 7. I wake up at 5. It's about an hour and a half, 2-hour ritual before I get Maverick, my son. But that wins the day for me. And then a little thing at the end of the night, my wife and I do a rose bud. A rose is something great that happened during the day, and a bud is something you're looking forward to. And we always finish the day with gratitude, and we haven't missed a day doing that. So that's big for us. My word for the year is optimism. I have a wristband that I wear, and Emily's word is gratitude. And we think about that daily. So that's kind of our personal habits.
So favorite comedians and favorite podcasts?
Favorite comedians. We're trying to surround ourselves with more comedy. So we watch New Girl. We laugh very much so on Schmidt. There's a lot of humor there. Podcasts. I'm Donald Miller, Story Brand. I'm Entree Leadership. I bounce around. I get into a person. So like Duncan Wardle, Innovation at Disney. I'll find him and listen to every podcast he's done. So once I try to go deep into certain things, and I'll search individual people. That's been helpful for me as well.
Any other questions, Amber?
Do any of your merchandise have electrolytes in them?
I'm very confused in that. Should they?
Potentially so, yes.
Okay. They're sprinkled with potassium. I know that.
That is amazing. Just as good.
That's all I got. That's all I got.
What anybody else have a question?
We have our Dolce and Banana underwear. That's the small banana, by the way. We have that over here. I'm underneath the stadium right now. So,
Ethan, we'll go to Ethan next. Ethan, if you want to talk about your business for a second and any questions you have for Jesse.
Yeah, sure. Hey, Jesse. Ethan here. I think I came into Derek's ISI group right after you left. I think I missed you by a little bit. At a startup in the real estate business doing security, helping buildings stay secure. And I'm just curious how strong you think the culture is that you've built up at this point. What happens if Jesse Cole leaves tomorrow?
Yeah, it's a great question. It got asked in the, we just had our book club. So we pay all our people to read. We do Better Book Club. And our book club book was nuts about Southwest, which is a great book to go back to, written almost 20 plus years ago. But the question was what happens when Herb Kelleher leaves and what would happen to Southwest. I found out with our first team, Gastonia, I was not a good leader and the team kind of fell. It dramatically fell. And may not be existent after this year. That was devastating to me for something that I built for 10 years with my wife. So the key is to build the stories, over communicate over and over again, talk to the people so that it does live on. And I've been testing this past year, especially with a lot more speaking and taking more speaking appearances all over and being gone. I was gone for almost every day in October, except for 3 days. And we actually grew as a business. And so, I'm spending most of my time on our leadership, on trying to get them to tell the stories, keep it going, you know. It scares me. I think energy is everything. And I think our team, that's my goal, is to bring fun and bring energy every day I show up. And I think our team isn't all like that, which is fine. But I get nervous about the energy levels. I think energy brings out more creativity, more purpose. And I want that in our team. So I'm focused now on also how do I bring other energy givers into our group as well to build that up. But it's a good question, and I wouldn't lie if it scares me.
Anybody else?
Hey, Jesse. I was wondering, you're a very creative guy. Do you ever get to the point where, you know, something maybe goes a little bit too far? I mean, do you have like a line where it's like, well, we don't want to do that, but you know what I mean?
Yeah, we've got very close, and I think the team checks me on that pretty regularly. There's a few videos that we haven't sent out. We've done some t-shirt campaigns that were just jokes, like a shirt so good you don't need pants. And then we've done some other ones with our Dolce and Banana underwear with a male model, but not a male model, pouring water over his head and just the underwear. We got some question marks on that. So I think where we're fortunate is when you build trust, when you put so much out, I think so many people rely on just like, hey, here's the campaign I'm doing now, or here's the post I'm gonna put now. We are so much into quantity leads to quality. When we've put so much out for a while, our fans give us the benefit of the doubt if we went a little too far over the edge. So we understand we're a family business, but we want to be cool for young people and fun and edgy. And so if it's too crazy, what I do is I send it to the team. And if I get more no's than yes, we'll usually put it on hold. And that's happened probably 3 or 4 times. So I don't know how that fits. Is there more specific for you on how you, like how that would help you, like that kind of question?
He left.
He left. He just didn't like the answer. I'm out.
Didn't like it being turned back around on him. we asked you questions. We asked.
That was a tough question. Anybody else?
Yeah, I have a question, Jesse. This is Peter Lasoski. I think I met you at Heroes Club one time. We talked for a little bit.
Excellent.
I mean, I can remember from the yellow. Who could forget? So my company is a software company. We actually deal in experiences. We talk about how do you create genuine and authentic human connection.
Yes.
Through our new platform. My question really is, you talked about this, and I used to play baseball, coach baseball for years. And, you know, in your line of work, probably your, even though it's a smaller stadium, you're going to be one of the last to come on where people can actually congregate and come back. And so I can see you're going to be in this for the long term. And, you know, you brought up something here just a couple minutes ago about energy. And so my question to you is really, how are you thinking about that as far as like an energy strategy? Because it is hard to, and you're trying to sense the energy of your team, your group, and maybe mix things up. But have you thought about like an energy strategy of how do you keep your team continue to focus and maybe even bring in new people to keep that energy at a really high level to innovate all the time?
Yeah, it's a great question. And to be honest, yesterday, you know, our bank said they dropped the ball, and so we missed the loan. and even though we applied on the first day, and so our president was devastated. And you know, it was a very, very tough conversations that we had. And I committed to them, just to say, hey guys, we're not letting anyone go. We're not going to do this, even if our season doesn't happen. What we're going to do. So there are things every day that can potentially bring the energy down. What we are doing that's helping with that is every day we have a lunch call. We have lunch together. And on the video, and we have lunch together. We sing the national anthem together, which is ridiculous. We have outfit best dressed. People wear ridiculous outfits. And the first thing we start every meeting, like many of you guys probably do, is quick wins. I think the key to keep energy up is to talk about what are the wins. And the fact that everyone does have a job now, not just has a job, obviously they can't sell tickets. They're not doing what they normally do. What they're doing is now producing content. And everyone, we have 10 platforms, everyone is involved in different content. And so like we do a Facebook Live and it had 650 comments. We're celebrating that. We have a new music video. We're celebrating that. So what are those little things that everyone can feel a part of? We had the Slipper Banana drive-through sold out in 20 whatever minutes yesterday. That's a win. So we're trying to give everyone the opportunity to celebrate those to keep the energy up. And then every Monday I share kind of the state of where we are financially. The challenges. And then we say, here's what we're going to do. And we paint that picture of opening night. So to answer your question, that's what we're doing now. I could say if we're going to keep being away from each other for a long time, we're going to have to get more creative, come up with more ideas. We'll have more idea paloozas, more happy hours. And yes, we'll bring fun people. I mean, some of our characters, we have a breakdancing first base coach. We have singers. We have circus people that are involved. We might bring them on our calls and say, all right, lead us here. Let's do a game. Let's have fun. So we're learning as much as anything, but I still think energy is everything. I wrote a post on LinkedIn 3 days ago. I didn't show up with energy the way, and it brought everyone down. And I was really devastated by that. And now I try to figure out how do you show up every day. So I hope that helps. For me, a trigger used to be, and still is, but when you, every door I come through, it's bring the energy, bring the fun. And so any door I walk through, that's what I tell. So now I'm trying to tell myself when I show up on a Zoom call, that's my door, bring the energy, bring the fun. And that's my trigger.
Thank you, Jesse. Great question, too. Anybody else take two more before we move? Jesse, I appreciate you.
Hey, Jesse.
Go ahead, John.
I had just a quick question. If you, looking back on your experience now, are there any moments or areas that you might have reconsidered now with your experience? Anything you might have done differently starting out?
Yeah, I would have sold more than two tickets the first 3 months, that kind of stuff. I think anything that we used to do that was to do short-term revenue. Like, so give you an example. We used to fans couldn't bring food into our stadium. And so we had like a Chick-fil-A night where you got Chick-fil-A meals and stuff, and fans would come in with their Chick-fil-A and we'd say, no, you have to stay outside the stadium. And they were like, upset. They were really upset. We used to do those things. Oh, well, they'll spend more money in the ballpark. We focused on that short-term stuff. And so I think I would have very quickly back then said, let our fans feel like they are taking advantage of us. And that's been kind of an experience that we've said, like, are all you can eat? Okay, go ahead, take advantage of us. And that's a value. So we started doing that very, very poorly in the beginning until we realized we had to go all in at fans first. And then the second thing I think is just, marketing and selling. I put myself in the shoes. If I see another sports team saying right now, 50% off shipping, 30% off this, 70% off this, it frustrates me so much because it seems so desperate. And so like, you're just trying to convince people to buy. Our team knows we will not put out posts that look or act salesy. And I think we did way too much of that in the beginning. And I think it hurt the brand.
We stopped doing events because we had to sell them. We, you know, we had Running of the Bananas, we had a Haunted Stadium, we had all these other events, but we had to promote them so much and sell them so much, it hurt the brand. So we eliminated our outside events to focus on not having to sell and just being there for our people. That's what we've changed. That's what we continue to change.
Jesse, you've got, thanks for your time today. Really appreciate you. You've got such a clear vision and mission. You guys, you heard everything hasn't gone perfectly for him. A lot of things haven't worked. He's in the same boat as us. He had the PPP or the other thing, and it didn't go through yet, right? So some people in here are dealing with that as well. And I mean, there's very, very real things he's dealing with, but his vision and his mission are so clear that he'll figure out a way to get past it. And I feel that way with our company as well. That's one thing I love about talking with Jesse. Hey, Ryan Cote has wanted to join in with a question as well before we go.
Is that okay? All right, cool. So when you're talking with your when you're advising companies, especially like agencies like us that have clients like Derek and I, what do you recommend to them when dealing with difficult clients? Trying to win them over or fire them? Like, what's your protocol for, you know, you're trying to like map out the client journey. You're trying to turn every client into a fan and make sure their experience is very strong. But when you have really difficult clients that don't respect your time or what have you, what do you recommend that you do with them?
Yeah. And when we started, we kept them because we needed it for money. We were money focused and we were like, oh, well, this is a good client, quote, money, because you put them in the highest levels. We just don't work with them anymore. And so, you know, you have to think, again, it's not just the cost of losing the money, it's the cost of the frustration for you and your team. And again, we talk more on now on ROP over ROI, return on purpose over return on investment. And again, I think everybody on your team needs to have purpose in what they're doing. And if they're dreading working with this client, or if that person's dreading working with them, it's, you guys all know this, it's toxic. And so how, all right, guys, if we were to lose them, what's the benefits? What's going to happen? Like, are you going to be aggressive to try to get new ones? Are we going to work on finding the ones that are right? So for us, we don't have necessarily an ideal client. Our ideal client is people that want to have fun. The businesses we work with, ideal people that are open to change, open to doing things differently. If someone is rigid and doesn't want to do things differently, they're not a good client for us from a business sense. And I think knowing that from the clients that you work with, if they're not what you're looking for and that's going to make you happy and get you excited to work with them, it doesn't make sense.
Okay, cool.
Thanks. And again, that's without context, Ryan. As you know, if it's without context, that's just an overall macro view of looking at it.
Yeah, I understand. Thanks.
Thanks. I got to see the mannequin again. That was very creepy.
There it is.
Jesse, any final thoughts you want to share with us?
Oh, me? No, guys, I appreciate Derek. You've it's obviously a great mastermind. I've learned so much from you over the last couple of years and what you're doing. So I'm just glad to be with you guys. And I'm excited. I guess everyone, I think there's so much hope to see what comes out of this. And I would challenge you to say, what were those things that you experimented with now that you never did before? And to look back and say, I'm so glad that I experimented with that. We are so excited to see these new things we're going to be doing. And we're only doing them because of the challenges right now. So create your experiment list and just start running. I think that's the only thing I would share.
We've got permission to do that right now too. Everything is kind of, there's been kind of a reset button. We have,
Wild if West.
Ever time for us to be, I have permission to experiment right now.
Yeah, 100%.
Awesome. Appreciate you, buddy. Look forward to seeing the next great things you're doing, and we'll talk to you soon.
Excellent. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is Derek Champagne inviting you to join me every Sunday morning for our business leadership series, where we interview leaders who are making an impact on their worlds.
Really minimize the negative stuff as much as possible.
I love your brand. To me, it's a lifestyle brand that's just very cool.
You have to be the person that is going to poke the most holes in your idea.
He has sold product in all 50 states. He's got a really cool product. Welcome to the program today.
You've done some pretty amazing things. You are in Vegas, Dallas, St. Louis, and Bentonville.
There is going to be that moment where you finally accomplish what you set out to accomplish.